July 4th, 1776. July 4th, 1996. 220 days of picnics and potato salads, fireworks, watermelon, goosebumps, and rivers of proud and patriotic tears. Representing 220 years of personal and religious freedom for a people known as Americans. As Christians in America, we believe that God is the original founding father of the United States. Our love for God and country is expressed in the hymn found on page 508 of our own hymnal. Ladies and gentlemen, I invite you to celebrate America the Beautiful with us from sea to shining sea.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies,
for
for purple mountain majesties,
above the fruited plain.
America, America, God shed his grace on thee.
Thank you. apple pies, baseball games and picnics in July.
That's America.
Fireworks and marching bands, a pride that only freedom understands. America to me. Open arms and willing hands, giving just to help her fellow man.
That's America.
Standing in defense of right, not afraid to give her all to fight.
That's America.
That's America. Him throughout our history.
That's America. That's America.
Families that stand and say, we will serve the Lord today. That's America. That's America. That's America. That's America to me. That's America.
Thank you.
The red, white, and blue, bald eagle, and Uncle Sam are among the many symbols which Americans associate with freedom. Our independence is honored in the Liberty Bell, first called the State House Bell. It arrived from England in September 1752. Before it was raised to the top of the Philadelphia State House Tower, it was hung from a temporary stand in the yard.
People wanted to hear it ring, so one morning the bell was tested. While a crowd looked on, a smiling bell ringer stepped up to the bell and swung its heavy clapper. A long bong resounded through the air, but almost at once the bell ringer's smile changed to a worried frown, for you see a crack had split the rim and raced up the side of the bell.
Rather than send the ruined bell back to England, the colonists decided to recast the bell in Philadelphia. It was broken into small pieces with sledgehammers and then melted down. The metal was then poured into new molds. However, this first recasting wasn't a success. When the new bell was hung in the State House Tower in April 1753, it made only a dull bonk when struck.
Starting over again, the bell was melted down and the metal poured into new molds. By June, it was hung in the State House Tower, and everyone in the yard below waited breathlessly as it was struck. The bell gave out a loud, echoing bong. On July the 8th, 1776, the State House bell rang to announce the first public reading of the Declaration of Independence.
The State House bell kept on ringing on important occasions until July 8th, 1835. On that morning, it was tolling for the funeral procession of John Marshall, Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court, when suddenly it cracked for the second time. Strangely enough, it was 59 years to the day since the bell had rung out to celebrate the first reading of the Declaration of Independence.
So even though it was now silent for good, the Liberty Bell had become a symbol of freedom for Americans. In 1876, a new bell was installed in the Tower of Independence Hall. The bell weighed 13,000 pounds, 1,000 for each of the 13 colonies, and was made from four Civil War cannons melted down. It chimed for the first time at 12:01 a.m. on July the 4th, 1876.
But it is still the silent Liberty Bell to which hundreds of thousands of people flock every year. There's an inscription on that bell from the Bible which reads, "Proclaim liberty throughout the land and to all the inhabitants thereof." Many people think this refers to the Declaration of Independence, but of course it couldn't, because that inscription was made 23 years before the Declaration was written. Instead, it refers to the freedom of religion, which is the right to all Americans.
Has always known that there is freedom, somehow breathed into the very soul of life. The prisoner, the powerless, the slave have always known it. There's just something that keeps reaching for the sky. And even a life begins because a baby fights for freedom. And songs we love to sing have freedom's theme. Have walked through fire and flood to find a place of freedom, and some faced hell itself for freedom's dream. creation, and he longed for us to all be free and whole. When my Lord brought freedom through the blood of his redemption, his cross stamped pardon on my
The oldest of our patriotic songs is Yankee Doodle. The word Yankee came from the first Dutch settlers to America. J-A-N-K-E, pronounced Yankee, is a familiar form of the Dutch name Jan, just as Johnny is the familiar form of John. The word doodle meant foolish fellow, a simpleton. The lyrics for Yankee Doodle were written in 1758 by Dr. Richard Shuckburgh, a British Army doctor who had come to serve in the American colonies. Like many of the British, Shuckburgh looked down on the poorly dressed, poorly educated Americans who came to enlist in the Army. He made fun of these volunteers in the lyrics.
Yankee Doodle went to town riding on a pony, stuck a feather in his hat and called it macaroni.
Shuckburgh's joke backfired, though. Americans liked the tune, and they added lyrics of their own. 20 years later, you could hear them whistling as they marched off into battle in the Revolutionary War.
Yankee Doodle is a tune Americans delight in. It suits for feast, it suits for fun, and just as well for fighting.
Yankee Doodle was sang at the first Independence Day celebration, July 4th, 1777, and it is still sung on the 4th of July today.
London just to ride the pony. I am a Yankee Doodle boy.
Oh boy!
I am a Yankee Doodle boy.
Yankee Doodle Dandy.
I am that boy. A Yankee Doodle
And 7 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note, nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
Never again would our nation's armies be divided. Since the resolve of our bitter inner conflict, the soldiers of America have united in numerous wars to save the sovereignty of the United States of America and to end tyranny throughout the world.
We don't have enough times or that many times to really thank our men and women who have served and fought in our armed forces, and so each year at this time, it's really a wonderful chance just to applaud them and thank them for the service that they've not only given to our country, but to each of us to keep our families safe on this continent. So may I have the lights up, please, and we'd like to recognize those men and women of our armed forces. First of all, if there are any of you here that served before World War II, would you stand, please? If there are any here who served before World War II. Yes. Now, those men and women who served during the Second World War, would you stand, please? God bless you. Thank you. And those of you who served from the end of World War II through the Korean War, would you stand, please? Those of you who served from the end of the Korean War through the Vietnam War, would you stand, please, and let us thank you. God bless you. And those who served from the end of the Vietnam War through Desert Storm, and even now, you're still serving, would you stand, please? Do we have any prisoners of war here? Would you stand, please? In any of the wars, if you're a prisoner of war, would you stand, please? Back here, yes. Up here. Yeah. Over here. And we'd like to recognize our widows and children and those who have had a husband or a child has had a mom or a dad or someone who's been killed during a war. Would you stand, please? Our widows and children of those who have lost loved ones. There's one over here. Back here, over here. We praise the Lord for you. This next song is especially for you. And when you hear a song that you particularly like or are proud of, would you please give a strong cheer or a yell and let us know about it?
Yeah. brings a few good men. Hit that beach again and again. These are the ones who save their land. All for the rains, give a hand.
The walls of Mount Azuma to the shores of Tripoli. People fight our country's battles in the air, on land, and sea. First is Michael, right, and freedom. And to keep our own and plead. We are proud to claim our title of the United States of America. To the music that kept us free, give their lives for liberty.
Can faith in God and country burn so deep in a man's soul that he would be willing to give up his own life to preserve those ideals for his fellow countrymen? Ask that question to these uniformed men and women on the platform here tonight, and you'll receive a loud and clear,
yes, sir!
A loud and clear, yes, sir, can be heard from the names on our memorial walls, the names in our history books, or a single name written on a War Department letter, lovingly placed with a medal in a mother's trunk of memories. A loud and clear, yes, sir, can be heard from those veterans in our audience tonight who are willing to sacrifice all for the name of freedom. To all those brave names, past and present, the people of America say thank you. The people of Bellevue say thank you. A hero can be in a military uniform, a dress, a suit and tie, or just plain old jeans and tennis shoes. Hero from the Greek means to watch over and protect. And from Webster's dictionary, a hero is a person admired for strength and courage, nobility and extraordinary exploits. Any person admired for qualities and achievements and regarded as an ideal or model. The central figure in any event or period. Honored for qualities outstanding.
He was only 21. He had been teaching school for 2 years when the war began. He was a little above average height, had fair skin, blue eyes, and light hair. He was involved in the Long Island campaign, which was just this side of disastrous. We were facing the enemy across the East River, not knowing what their plans might be. Fearing surprise more than anything, General Washington wanted someone to sneak over the lines and get information. Spying is a dirty job and nobody wanted to do it, so Nate volunteered. There's something about taking on the job that's got to be done that's a custom of American heroes. He was sent through the enemy lines dressed like a Dutch schoolmaster. He got what he went after and was on his way back when the British found the information on him. He admitted he was a spy and they hanged him the next morning. He had written some letters home, but the British destroyed them so that the rebels would not know they had a man who could die so firmly. In his last moment, they let him say what he wanted to. He was just a young American who had no time to do anything memorable but die. So he stood there with a noose around his neck and told him his rank, Captain. His name, Nathan Hale, and then added, I only regret that I have but one life to lose for my country. And he showed the world what Americans are made of. Nathan Hale, a true American hero.
Down their lives for what they knew was right. This country's brightest heroes ablaze in freedom's light. And as they stood strong in their fight for all the world to see, their voices rang across the land for all who would be free. Who will stand for freedom? And who will fight for liberty? Who will pay the price for freedom demands a sacrifice? Who will stand for freedom? Who will stand?
Ron Richardson and Larry Mathis became friends in 1979. Serving as deacons side by side at their church and playing on a championship softball team. As the years passed, their friendship deepened through shared joys and hard times. Because of Larry's Christian character, Ron grew to love and respect his friend as a godly example of what a man should be. In fact, Larry's love and dedication for his job as a firefighter inspired Ron to pursue the same career. In the early morning hours of April 11th, 1994, the two firefighters responded separately to a high-rise apartment fire in downtown Memphis. Larry on an engine company and Ron on an aerial ladder truck. That fire placed Ron Richardson on a strategic rescue team that saved the lives of 3 adults and 3 children from the 9th, 10th, and 11th floors of the building. At the same time, Ron's friend and co-worker, Larry Mathis, lost his battle with the blaze. He gave his life in the line of duty. Ron continues to draw strength from the legacy of Larry's life, and he finds comfort in knowing that his friend is in the presence of God. One day, they will stand together again.
Ladies and gentlemen, Larry Mathis, Ron Richardson.
Who answered freedom's call throughout our history, joined themselves together to keep this nation free. They paid in pain and suffering, they gave their lives away. And even in their dying breath, you could hear them say, who will stand?
When this young lady joined Bellevue in 1946, her spirit of commitment to serve the Lord had already been sealed in her heart. She met her future husband here at Bellevue, and it wasn't long after they were married that she got involved teaching preschoolers. Right away, her love for children was evident. At the same time, she started her own family while never giving up the teaching of young children. Her four sons grew up through the preschool and children's ministries at Bellevue. Today, she has 9 grandchildren, 3 of which live in Memphis. Whenever one of her grandchildren turn 5, they joyfully come to Memphis and Bellevue for Grandma's Sunday School class. In addition to being a dedicated Sunday School teacher of some 50 years, she has also been active in women's ministry, Sunbeams, and Mission Friends. Her loving husband was a deacon for many years and is still active on various committees. Addie Mae Powers has dedicated 50 years of her life to shaping the moral attitudes of hundreds of future Americans. She never fought in a war. She never entered a burning building. But Addie Mae Powers is a true American hero.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Mae Powers.
And still today the call goes out for the flame of freedom high. There's a choice to make and a stand to take. We can't let freedom die. Don't let freedom.
On October 4, 1982, a joint session of the House of Representatives and the Senate in the second session of the 97th Congress declared that 1983 should be the National Year of the Bible, Public Law 97-280.
Whereas the Bible, the Word of God, has made a unique contribution in the shaping of the United States as a distinctive and blessed nation and people.
Whereas deeply held religious convictions springing from the early scriptures led to the early settlement of this great nation.
Whereas biblical teachings inspires concepts of civil government that are contained in our Declaration of Independence and Constitution of the United States.
Whereas many of our nation's great leaders, among them Presidents Washington, Jackson, Lincoln, and Wilson, paid tribute to the surpassing influence of the Bible in our country's development. As in the words of President Jackson, that the Bible is the rock on which our republic rests.
Whereas the history of our nation clearly illustrates the value of voluntarily applying the teachings of scriptures in the lives of individuals, families, and societies.
Whereas this nation now faces great challenges that will test this nation as it has never been tested before.
Whereas that renewing our knowledge of and faith in God through Holy Scripture can strengthen us as a nation and a people. Now, therefore, be it
resolved by the Senate and the House of Representatives of the United States of America in Congress assembled that the President is authorized and requested to designate 1983 as a National Year of the Bible in recognition of both the formative influence the Bible has been for our nation and our national need to study and apply the teachings of the Holy Scriptures. Thomas P. O'Neill, Speaker of the House, Strom Thurmond, President of the Senate Pro Tempore, approved October 4, 1982, Ronald Reagan. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Live as free men, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as servants of God. 1 Peter 2:16. Ladies and gentlemen, from the State House to the courthouse to the church house to your house, we need God in America again.
George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Samuel Adams, First Chief Justice John Jay. Names synonymous with the spirit of our country, founding fathers of the USA. Over 200 years ago, they shook off the chains of tyranny from Great Britain by divine call. Citing 27 biblical violations, they wrote the Declaration of Independence with liberty and justice for all. But something has happened since Jefferson called the Bible the cornerstone for American liberty, that put it in our schools as a light. Or since "Give me liberty or give me death," Patrick Henry said, our country was founded on the gospel of Jesus Christ. We eliminated God from the equation of American life, thus eliminating the reason this nation first began. From beyond the grave, we hear the voices of our founding fathers plead, you need God in America again. Of the 55 men who formed the Constitution, 52 were active members of their church. Founding fathers like Noah Webster, who wrote the first dictionary, could literally quote the Bible chapter and verse. James Madison said, we've staked our future on our ability to follow the Ten Commandments with all our heart. These men believed you couldn't even call yourself an American if you subvert the Word of God. In his farewell address, Washington said, you can't have national morality apart from religious principle, and it's true. Because right now we have over 150,000 kids carrying guns to these war zones we call public schools. In the 40s and 50s, student problems were chewing gum and talking. In the 90s, rape and murder are the trend. The only way this nation can even hope to last this decade is to put God in America again.
The only hope for America is Jesus. The only hope for our country is Him. If we repent of our ways, stand firm and say we need God in America again.
Abe Lincoln said the philosophy of the schoolroom in one generation will be the philosophy of government in the next. So when you eliminate the Word of God from the classroom and politics, you eliminate the nation that that Word protects. America is now number one in teen pregnancy and violent crime, number one in illiteracy, drug use, and divorce. Every day a new Holocaust of 5,000 unborn die, while pornography floods our streets like open sewers. America's dead and dying hand is on the threshold of the church, while the spirit of Sodom and Gomorrah affects us all. When it gets to the point where people would rather come out of the closet than clean it, it's a sign the judgment of God is gonna fall. If there's ever been a time to rise up, church, it's now. And as the blood-bought saints of the living God proclaim that it's time to sound the alarm from the church house to the White House and say, we want God in America again. Proclaim that one nation under God is our demand. And send this evil lifestyle back to Satan where it came from. Let the Word of God revive our dying land. For Jesus Christ is coming back again in all His glory, and every eye shall see Him on that day. That's why a new anointing of God's power is coming on us, to boldly tell the world you must be saved. Because astrology won't save you. Your horoscope won't save you. The Bible says these things are all a farce. If you've been born again, you don't need to look to the stars for your answers. You can look to the very one who made those stars. Listen, history tells us time and time again, to live like there's no God makes you a fool. You want to see kids live right? Stop handing out condoms. Start handing out the Word of God in school.
The only hope for our country is here. If we repent
On June 14, 1777, Congress made the following resolution: that the flag of the United States shall be 13 stripes, alternate red and white, with a union of 13 stars of white on a blue field. Legislation enacted in 1818 established a number of stripes at 13 and instituted the policy that on the admission of every new state into the Union, one star be added to the union of the flag.
Today, the flag consists of 13 horizontal stripes, 7 red alternating with 6 white, and in the upper corner near the staff, a rectangular blue field or canton containing 50 5-pointed white stars. The stripes symbolize the 13 colonies that originally constituted the United States of America.
The stars represent the 50 states in the Union. In the language of the Continental Congress, which defined the symbolic meanings of the colors red, white, and blue as used in the flag, white signifies purity and innocence, red, hardiness and valor, and blue, vigilance, perseverance, and justice.
On July 21, 1776, Mrs. John Abigail Adams wrote to her husband from Boston. She had just heard the first reading of the Declaration of Independence. He was still in Philadelphia with the Second Continental Congress, which had declared it.
Last Thursday, after hearing a very good sermon, I went with the multitude into King Street to hear the proclamation for independence read and proclaimed. Some field pieces were brought there. The troops appeared under arms, and all the inhabitants assembled there. The smallpox prevented many thousands coming from the country. Colonel Crafts read from the balcony of the State House the proclamation. Great attention was given to every word. As soon as he ended, the cry from the balcony was, "God save our American states!" And then three cheers which rent the air. The bells rang, the privateers fired, and the forts and batteries, the cannons were discharged. The platoons followed, and every face appeared joyful.
God save our American states! God save our American states! God save our American states!
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight? Broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through
Well, amen and amen. Thank God for America. What a wonderful, wonderful country. God has blessed us, and we love patriotism. But my friend, the most patriotic thing you can do is not to wave a flag or say, my country, right or wrong, or join the armed forces. I say this from my heart. The most patriotic thing you can do for this country is to give your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ and to live for Him. America needs a spiritual revival, and it must begin in my heart and yours. Are you saved? Are you ready to meet God? Has that burden of sin been lifted, and do you have peace with God? Would you like to be saved? Jesus died for you. And the Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Every sin forgiven, the burden of sin lifted, the joy of Jesus in your heart, and heaven for a blessed assurance. I invite you to pray this prayer right now, this moment, and invite Jesus Christ into your heart. Pray like this. Pray it sincerely. If you're with others, you may pray silently, but pray it sincerely. Dear God, I know that you love me. I know that you want to save me. Jesus, thank you for dying for me. Thank you for paying for my sin with your blood on the cross. I now, by faith, open my heart. I receive you as my Savior, my Lord, my Master, and my friend. Begin now, Lord Jesus, to make me the person you want me to be. And I will live for you by your grace and for your glory. Did you pray that prayer? You say, Pastor, I can't remember all of that. Just put it in a sentence. Lord, save me. Now, if you pray that and mean it, write me and I'll send you some literature to help you to get started in the Christian life. I've written a booklet. It's called Blessed Assurance, a No-So Salvation. And if you prayed and asked Christ to come into your heart, write to me and ask me for the booklet, Blessed Assurance. We'll send it to you with joy, no cost to you whatsoever. If you can, of course, enclose an offering, we'll appreciate it. But if you prayed and asked Christ to come into your heart, just write and ask for the Assurance booklet. That's all you need to remember, just the Assurance booklet. God bless you and keep you.